Aaron Dodd is up next. He's Research Fellow for Biosecurity and Environmental Economics at CEBRA at the University of Melbourne. He's also a BQMAC member, and he joins us now to share how we are advancing the Biosecurity Commons project. Over to you, Aaron. We've got that. That's great. Thanks, Aaron. We just got you on mute.
Thanks, Steph. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm joining you today from Dja Dja Wurrung country, and I'd like to pay my respects to their owners, their traditional elders, past and present. I'm talking to you today about the Biosecurity Commons project, but perhaps more broadly about technology and practice. And what I would like to do to start is just to ask you a simple question. Who remembers the Yellow Pages? In the old days, if we wanted to go and find a plumber, for instance, we'd go to the Yellow Pages, we'd skip to the section about plumbers, and we'd get a list of particular people. Some might have glossy ads, some might just have a single line. And when we asked that information, we'd form some judgment about how far away they were, whether they had a nice glossy ad, and we'd ring up a few people, we might talk to our mates, and we'd make a decision about which particular plumber we might choose to engage. And that was a lengthy process, because basically each time we wanted to go through that process, we had to start from scratch. And of course, we don't do this anymore. You know, the Yellow Pages, I'm surprised to hear, actually does still exist. But for the most of us these days, we just go to old Dr. Google. And what we do when we get that is that we get a result very quickly, and we get a result that draws on a whole lot of deep thinking that goes on in the background that we don't really know about. I heard a statistic recently that for every Google search that you do, it's something like the equivalent of operating a 100-watt light bulb for an hour is the amount of computing power that goes in to return that Google search to you. So whilst we see here, you know, 0.45 seconds for that result to come back, there's some pretty heavy liftings happened in the background to get you that result. And what we get is, based on here, I'm not from Queensland, so I'm interested in getting a plumber in Dalby. I need to either ring somebody there locally, but what I'm able to do by accessing those algorithms that sit in the background is get some rating or some ranking that's prioritized, rank those on the basis of how many people have clicked through the links, the quality of the reviews that have been received, and some specifications that I've put in. Now, that process should sound pretty familiar for most of you, because that's basically the same process that we go through when we try and figure out what our priority pests are. We have a look in the areas, you know, if we're from horticulture, we go to the horticulture section. We have a look in our adjoining countries and we see what particular pests they care about. And then we make some judgment about the likelihood that they'll be able to come to our location and, you know, some estimate of cost. Before reaching some judgment about whether or not we think that they're potentially going to be problematic. And the question that should pose in all of our minds is, why are we doing that? Is that still appropriate? And the answer may well be yes. It's not a loaded question. And is that, as Malcolm said, though, the absence of some science in this place, in this space, helping us to be able to make these kind of recommendations and these decisions? And the answer is that there's not, because there's a lack of science. There's plenty of science in this space. And for the rest of the presentation, I'm going to talk about this in the context of surveillance. Surveillance is obviously something that's usually topical at the moment. But back in 2006, 2007, 2008, there was work done by our research centre, for instance, that developed this method of search and destroy down in the bottom right-hand corner there, that is actually used in practice by the Victorian government as part of their orange hawkweed eradication program in the Victorian Alps to design their surveillance program. It's been developed, it's best practice, it's published in Ecology Letters, which is the world's leading ecology journal, highly ranked, highly cited, available to anybody in the world to be able to use that technique. The question is then why? Why is it not being more broadly used than the Victorian government? Why aren't we using that in New South Wales? Why aren't we using that in Queensland? And at least part of that is to do with this. I'm someone who's trained in being able to interpret this jargon, and this is the language of science. The challenge is several fold. Firstly, to get access to this, it's probably going to be behind a paywall. Secondly, you've then got to be able to interpret the maths. And for a lot of people, this is kind of really quite triggering. I mean, I look at this and I get sweaty palms because I know it's going to take me, some time to be able to sit here and digest what's been proposed. But then immediately what happens is that it's not just a matter of being able to understand the maths. We've got to have the data to drive the maths. We've got to have the ability to translate this mathematics into software code, which is a different step again. We've then got problems potentially where that software code might have been developed, but it might be licensed. And that license might come with a fee, which in some cases might be quite large. Vicky Panchin-Neal, who's probably the world's leading person for designing invasive species surveillance programs, codes all of her work in MATLAB if she publishes her code, which is she's doing increasingly for more recent work. MATLAB comes with a license fee that costs several thousand dollars and is essentially an expert user skill. So we're in this situation where we've got all this fantastic research and it's not being uptaken. For those of you that were present at the 2019 Research Innovation Workshop that was held over at South Bank, that what this was described as is the Valley of Death. So this is basically where, you know, there's an enormous amount of investment goes into our research. And as that research starts to deliver results, investment in that area starts to decline. And there's kind of this assumption that, you know, we've done this great applied research, it'll be able to be adopted into practice relatively easily. And this particular context is talking about commercialization, but really what we're talking about in this context is implementation or innovation. And what we need is some bridges to be able to help us span that research to commercialization or research to adoption divide. Of course, as Malcolm's touched on, you know, it's like, who knew that this existed? Well, basically everybody knows that this exists. This is a challenge that's been going on for some time. As I said before, this work that was done by our centre as early as, you know, 15 years ago to answer some of these questions, and they're really only being adopted in limited places. So the Crake Review recommended, as Malcolm's touched on, so I won't labour on it, that the need to not only look at research, but also pathways to adoption, innovations, and development of tools to translate what is present in those papers, which are methods, statistical methods, mathematical methods, computational methods, into tools and innovations that are actually able to use to support the policy making and the decision making process, in particular at the national scale. And at that workshop, quite surreptitiously, potentially, the Eco Commons program manager at the time, a lady called Sarah Richmond, got up and gave a presentation. And she gave a presentation about what was then referred to as BCCVL. And I'll show you some screenshots from that later on. And I reckon you could have heard a pin drop in the room at the time. I was sitting next to the principal epidemiologist for Victoria at the workshop. And she's worked in both Australia and New Zealand, now has transferred from Victoria to New South Wales, very experienced veterinary epidemiologist. And she elbowed me in the guts and said, we need one of those. And what Eco Commons really represents is that bridge. Eco Commons is a currently $5 million program that's scheduled to run between 2020 and 2023 to uplift a series of existing eco-informatics platforms that provide access to curated data sets paired with methods that have been translated into tools. So where somebody has gone and taken a peer-reviewed method, they've converted it into a piece of software code that they are then able to deploy in a cloud environment, which means we compare data, curated data, with software, with compute capacity to actually do the kind of analytics that we want. That was 2019. So one little diversion that I do want to take, because I think there's a couple of really important messages here, is that, you know, the Crake Review concluded in 2017. The initial workshop that explored these ideas and that Malcolm presented earlier on was in 2018. There was a workshop in 2019, it was prioritised by NBC working group, but there was no money. So we had to go back to the drawing board, we refactored the proposal, we thought about it a bit more, and it did come as an idea to this partnership for those of you that were present 2 years ago in 2019, and it was seen as a priority, something that should be funded. So we pitched it to QCIF, which is the Queensland Cyber Infrastructure Foundation, and they came back to us and said one of these things already existed, which caused most of us to just about fall off our chair. But by that time, the decision had been made and we weren't able to proceed. But the really, I think the breakthrough came late last year. So there was an opportunity for some money and a couple of co-investment schemes that arised. And what was able to happen was that because of the work that had been undertaken, the fact that the thinking had been done, when those schemes became available, BQMAC took a look at a series of proposals that were on the table and again prioritised Biosecurity Commons as something that was worth investing in. And that was sufficient to get QDAF to buy in, to get Dodd to buy in, and then ultimately on the strength of the case that was put forward by both of those two partners and the work that had undergone over many years, Australian Research Data Commons, which is an entity that's funded through the consortium of Australian government universities, agreed to co-fund the platform, which was enough to get it across the line for a project start this year. But it's something I want to emphasise is that that's a long process. When we started on this journey, I was single, didn't have any kids, lived in a different house and didn't own a cat. And all of those things have come to pass. So, there's a lot of change has happened in the world since then. But we're now at the point of getting to a project. But it demonstrates that, good ideas with the right champions following through the process, are able to make change, but that change takes time. What is this Biosecurity Commons business? Biosecurity Commons is essentially a decision support platform. And what we aim to do is to take the best bits of Eco Commons, the core shared infrastructure of Eco Commons that allows users to log in, data to be stored, models to be run, the coordination of all of the pieces of IT tech that need to happen in the background, that they have been able to deliver with their money, to leverage that with a much smaller amount of money, and then for us to add in new functionality to that platform so that we can use the best available data, the new tools that we add in, and the computing power that's available there is in the cloud to help really uplift the quality of our decision support tools in biosecurity. Basically, what that looks like is this. So we have four key deliverables over the two-year period. The first, and this one is really important, is collaborative governance. Yes, this is a project that's been funded by Queensland and Commonwealth Government along with ARDC, but that doesn't mean that they are the only people that are going to be involved in using it. That doesn't mean that they're the only people that are going to be responsible in terms of in respect to making decisions about how that program is designed and delivered. In particular, the Science Advisory Committee will form or will comprise people from across Australia and New Zealand who are experts in developing these kinds of methods, but also end users. And it's really important to the project team that end users are adequately represented on the advisory committee, because if we develop a series of tools that aren't useful to end users, then we've not met our end brief. Secondly, what we need to do is we need to have a working platform. The key thing there to emphasise, and this is perhaps unusual for a lot of projects, is that we will be open source. So that all the work that we do at the end of the project, all the contracts, very clear, will be completely open in terms of people being able to take and reuse and adopt that code base for whatever purposes they wish, provided that they attribute the original source. It'll also be open access. So we're developing this tool, and I just to single out somebody, if I saw Michelle on the call before, if Australian Banana Growers Corporation wants to use the tool for their particular purposes, they'll be freely able to log in and do so. If Sunpork wants to log in and use the platform for their particular purposes, they'll be freely able to do so. Invasive Species Council wants to log in and use the platform for their particular purposes, they'll be freely able to do so. It's an open access platform. Now, that doesn't mean that the data that might be brought in by Sunpork is able to be seen by everybody else. The individual user logins, secure platform where data can be shared with people that it is appropriate to share it with. But having all of those things in one place means that if, for instance, consultative committee goes through the process of making a decision about a particular species the analysis that they produce at the end, someone could press the share button and it's available to all other users. So rather than going through that age-old process that we go through where Victoria goes away, develops a species distribution map for a new introduced species, and sends it around via email, and all of the information about how that particular data product was built is lost and stripped away. By having it here all in one place, being able to be joined up, we can actually track the full metadata of the object about what data it was built upon, where it came from, how it was analyzed, right alongside the final product. We're going to build 5 new workflows, and I'll explain in the next slide really about what those are. And once those are developed, and indeed throughout the course of developing those things, there'll also be a series of programs that we develop to help people upskill in terms of understanding and being able to use the platform and also user support. Probably the one thing that's worth emphasizing at this point in terms of what we're not going to do is that we're not a data repository. We're an analytics platform. Most of the most common misconception I see, even when I see people hear about talk about Eco Commons or Biosecurity Commons, is that they're like, oh, you know, we're going to drag all this data in and I'm uncomfortable about sharing my data with this organization. The intention very much is that data custodians will still be data custodians. If an agency wants to bring, or an organization wants to bring data into the platform for their own analysis and for their own purposes, the point at which they've completed their analysis and pressed save on the results, the data disappears. The intention here is to enable people to access data that is shared with them, not for us to hold people's and organizations' data. We're not going to recreate AusPestCheck, for those of you that are familiar with that platform. AusPestCheck is AusPestCheck, and AusPestCheck will remain AusPestCheck. But if somebody wants to be able to draw data out of AusPestCheck potentially in the future, then you know we can have a conversation about that time, about what the required mechanisms are for someone to do an analysis of data held in AusPestCheck securely within Biosecurity Commons. So we've got 5 workflows, and as I said before, we're leveraging Eco Commons. We're not recreating Eco Commons, and we're not doing things from scratch that have already been done. Species distribution modeling is a core element of threatened species conservation, understanding how species are constrained to niches and the extent to which those niches may change with climate change and other threatening processes. So we're going to take that work and we're going to leverage it, because species distribution modeling is also the first step in building a risk map. Building a risk map is the first step in allocating surveillance effort. Once we've done our surveillance effort, we can then, at the end of an eradication program, start to look at doing proof of freedom. But the beauty of having all of these things in one place is that actually we don't need to export data sets, download, change file formats, upload, bring it back in, hope that it's in the right format, reorganize the columns because the tool that we're using is different to the tool that we were using previously. Again, with all that metadata flowing through the process. So that the 5 boxes that you see here on the right are the 5 new boxes that we're going to be developing. And really the emphasis is on saying surveillance design is a generic thing. There are a series of methods by which we might do surveillance design. The first of those might be Becky Epanchin-Neal's method that we talked about before, which is about cost minimization. It's actually the second one on this list. The original Hauser and McCarthy search and destroy model is based on benefit maximization. So you can go into the platform, you can say, okay, well, given my species distribution model and given my risk map, I'd like to design a surveillance program where I have a series of pieces of information about how sensitive my traps are, how much they might cost, and what my budget is. I can select which particular model I want to use to do that. And rather than going through the process of having to code all of that up, I'm able to do it using a point-and-click interface. And that's what we're trying to achieve by this idea of design by users for users. So following an agile approach, taking user-centric design and actually sitting down with users saying, well, when you develop a species distribution model, how do you do it? And we've been through this process recently as part of the uplift of BCCVL into Eco Commons. And we've said, well, what are the steps that you actually follow? And what is the requirements or the features that you require to be able to do that? And then what we're able to do is we can translate that into a web page. This is HTML. This is an example. So you can see here the points that we had on the previous slide. Each of those, the description, you know, first occurrences. So rather than having to go to Atlas of Living Australia or go to GBIF or go to CABI download occurrence records, drag them in, do filtering, save them locally on your disk, then go to a different piece of software. All of that happens here in one place. This is not this particular example, this screenshot that I'm showing here. This is not pipe dream. This is not could happen. This is live, able to do. You can see up the top, I've logged in. We can do this now. Then what we're able to do is, rather than doing command line code, we just simply enter the pieces of data or the parameters that we need to be able to use to populate those tools. That's the key thing. So we've lowered the bar of entry. We've lowered the cost of entry to be able to use these methods by translating them into easy to use tools. Perhaps the last thing before I wrap up that I want to show you is to show you what's possible. This is a risk map that's been recently peer reviewed, published 4 weeks ago. This is a multi-species risk map that comprises, I think if my memory serves me correctly, about 20 different high risk plant pests of entry into Australia, where they're most likely to arrive, enter establishment, ultimately cause harm. That is effectively taking the first two of those workflows that we've described there on that previous slide about the seven workflows that will ultimately be available in Eco Commons. But this project goes one step further. Within the same functionality, it then says, okay, well, if that's what the risk map looks like, what does that mean for surveillance? Where should we allocate our surveillance effort? So that this little diagram up here, this little part out of the top corner of that, is if we were to zoom in the area around Brisbane, and we can actually see, well, you know, surprise, surprise, allocation around the airport, allocation around the port, some emphasis just to the north of the CBD, and I'm not completely familiar with Brisbane, so I'm not sure what's going on here, but the model has picked up that there's some risk areas over here that potentially need to be looked at. This something published 4 weeks ago. This will be available in Biosecurity Commons within the year. So compared to where we were with that pre-existing situation, tools and methods developed 2009, still not in widespread use because the barriers of entry are too high. What we're hoping to achieve with Biosecurity Commons, and what I'm confident we will achieve, is taking tools, peer-reviewed methods, peer-reviewed models, and making them available, lowering that cost of entry so that users that want to be able to do these kinds of analyses can do these analyses, and they're not prevented from doing so, not because they don't have a good understanding of the science, but simply because they don't have a good understanding of software carpentry or IT or barriers of entry or lack of access to compute. That's it from me. I do encourage you to get in touch if you are interested in the project. We will be doing some more user requirements workshops in the not too distant future, and then following that user acceptance testing. So if you are interested, please get in touch and we can have a conversation about how you might be able to get more involved. Thanks.
Thanks so much, Aaron. And taking him up on that, you can even send a question in the comments box today, and I'm sure Aaron wouldn't mind typing a response today. It's really awesome to see how far this project has advanced from where it came from as an idea just a couple of years ago, and the direction and the opportunities for all of us moving forward. So thanks for that update, Aaron.